Well, good morning, or good afternoon, rather. I am Marco Norici. I work at the University of Padova, and I'm very pleased to introduce this plenary on producing force and sensing strain, where biomechanics and molecular biology meet. This is indeed a very timely and important topic, since scientists on both sides have been struggling for a very long time, and still are, to find mechanisms regulating force production and the mechanism of sensing force, and how the apparatus of sensing force translates to the regulation of muscle mass and muscle growth in various conditions, such as aging, disuse, exercise, and how this results in an accretion of muscle mass, which will then result in force production. And of course, one of the key features of skeletal muscle is producing movement. But today, actually, there is still quite a lot of gaps in the understanding on how muscles achieve this fine regulation of force in various type of contraction, isometric, lengthening contraction, shortening contractions, where we are asked, where the muscle is asked to perform, often with changing length, despite the fact that neural drive needs to be constant or according to the contraction, finally regulated to maximize and optimize movement and contraction. So today we have two excellent speakers from the muscle side and from the molecular biology side. We have Professor Daniel Hahn from the University of Ruhr in Germany. He also holds a visiting professorship at the University of Queensland in Australia. And his research focuses on the interaction of intact muscle tendon complex and the nervous system to produce force under varying conditions and task demands. He is author of many publications and relating to the in vivo muscle function. And he will contribute to this plenary with a biomechanics viewpoint on force production. Our other speaker, Professor Barbara Wessner from the University of Vienna, her main research interests comprise molecular mechanism underlying exercise-induced adaptation of skeletal muscle cells. Recently, several projects highlighted the role of the extracellular matrix remodeling in response to exercise stimuli, and this is one of her main topics of research. She will summarize the molecular mechanism involved in sensing strain. So it is my pleasure to introduce the first speaker, Professor Daniel Hahn. Daniel Hahn, he has an interesting CV since he originally graduated in Germany. He took a diploma in sports science at the University of Munich. He then moved to the Technical University of Munich. And in 2010, he received a postdoc visiting position at the Center for Sensorimotor Neuroscience, School of Human Movement Studies at the University of Queensland in Brisbane, Australia. He then went back to Germany, where he was appointed in a position called a substitute professorship, which is like an associate professorship. And Then in 2013, he was nominated full professor in human movement sciences at at the Department of Exercise Science at the Faculty of Sports at the University of Ruhr, Bochum, Germany. Is a well-known authority in muscle mechanics, and his research covers a variety of topics which involve mechanics of muscle contraction applied to different types of contraction, isometric, concentric, and eccentric, the behavior of the muscle tendon complex during repeated stretch-shortening cycle, the effect of contraction history on muscle force production in various conditions, and the effect of residual force enhancement, which is a very intriguing phenomenon, which consists of the enhancement of isometric force following active stretching of the muscle when the neural activation is constant. So without further ado, it is my pleasure to introduce the first talk of Professor Han, who will speak about the history dependence of muscle action, highly relevant, but mostly neglected.
Thank you, Malcolm, for this nice introduction. And just while I'm setting up my presentation, so hopefully everyone can see this. So also from my side, good morning, good afternoon, good evening to everyone, wherever you are when listening to this plenary. And hopefully we can show you in these two plenaries interesting aspects, just as Marco introduced, about muscle function, also how muscle can be built by training due to force sensing. So my first part will be about muscle mechanics. And before I actually start with my presentation, I will give you a brief overview. So I would like to start with some basics of muscle function and muscular force production, because we probably have the typical ECSS wide audience from different disciplines in sports science. So hopefully everyone can follow my presentation. And after these basics, I actually introduce what Marco already mentioned, the history dependence of muscle action. What is this? And then, as in my title, I will show you why I think this is really relevant and we should care more about this phenomenon, because I think we still many things unknown which we might use in different scenarios. So, and then I will present some unresolved questions and future directions to hopefully motivate young researchers, PhD students, master students to move into sports science, to hopefully resolve these questions to move sports science forward. And then at the end, I will also pick up the title of this keynote. So why this is linked? Why is biomechanics and molecular biology linked? So because muscles produce force, but they also sense the force they produce, which might be important then to cause adaptations to muscles. Okay, let's start. So at least to me, and I think to many others, muscles are, I think, really fascinating. So here you see this figure of a human, and we have approximately 400 skeletal muscles. And the more intriguing fact is, our muscles can really produce huge forces. So for example, in the Achilles tendon, forces have been recorded of approximately 10,000 newtons. Imagine this is 10 tons on a rope. And this was during moderate running speed. Just imagine if a Usain Bolt is running at full speed, how big, how large these forces could potentially be. And also, as Marco said, muscles enable movement, locomotion. They guarantee our posture. They're important for health. And of course, they're the basis of sports performance. And muscles have multiple functions. So they can be motors, they can be brakes, they can be springs, but can also be struts. And in other words, muscles are the motors of life. So this is why I think as sports scientists, we should care about muscles and their function. So, but interestingly, in here, quoting Walter Herzog from the University of Calgary, despite centuries of research on muscle and its contractile behavior, some aspects of muscular force production have still not been resolved. And also this is intriguing to me, because I think
humans do crazy things. We fly in outer space, but we still do not understand our own muscles. So, and I think, at least to me, this is why muscles are still a very intriguing field of research in biomechanics, but also in sports science. So what do we know about muscle function? So some basics now, so that everyone can hopefully follow this keynote. So our current theory is the cross-bridge theory that explains muscular force production. Here you see on the y-axis the force produced, and on the x-axis the muscle length and sarcomere length. And it's well known that the force a muscle can produce depends on its length. So, and this is because of the overlap of the myofilaments, so the actin and myosin, and how many cross bridges can be built. So when we know the length of the muscle, this means we know the force it can produce. Then there's a second very important aspect. So this is the velocity. A muscle is changing its length. So here's the typical force-velocity relation. You have the force again on the y-axis and the velocity on the x-axis. And we know quite well when the force is in, when the velocity is increasing, the force we can produce is reduced. And the third aspect, also mentioned by Marco, is the neural drive. So if we know these three factors, we can predict, or we should be able to predict, muscle force based on our cross-bridge theory. So the force a muscle can produce depends on its length, its velocity, and its activation. So remember this, because I will use this quite a bit to illustrate some examples to you what we would expect a muscle can do based on our theory, and what we actually observe in different kind of experiments. So, and to further elaborate on this, again, you see here the force on the y-axis and the velocity on the x-axis. And when the muscle is contracting at zero velocity, we call this an isometric contraction, because there's no length change. Isometric contractions are usually our reference contractions. And if we are at an optimal length, velocity is zero, activation is full, then we can go to this dashed line, to the y-axis, we produce 100% force. If a muscle is shortening, so then it acts as a motor. We talk of a concentric or shortening contraction, and the forces are less than during an isometric reference contraction, depending on the velocity. If a muscle is lengthened while it's active, we talk about an eccentric contraction. Then the muscle acts as a brake and can produce forces up to 150% of the isometric reference contraction. And why am I mentioning these eccentric and concentric contractions? Because these two contraction types actually trigger those history-dependent effects. So they occur because of shortening or lengthening. This is why it's important that we have these basics. So what is actually this history dependence of muscle action? So very generally speaking, we could say history dependence refers to the fact that human physiology depends on proactivity. This is not necessarily related just to muscle, but to many other things. But more specifically, what I'm talking about is muscle force production. And here we have two phenomena. So muscle force capacity, this means the force a muscle can produce, is enhanced following eccentric lengthening actions, but it's depressed following concentric shortening actions. This will be illustrated in the next slides quite a bit so that you understand what this is. And I always thought the term history dependence might be a bit confusing. Actually, I think it's interesting that in one of the original papers of Abbott and Orbit, they called it plasticity in striated muscle. And I would actually argue we could say it's the instantaneous plasticity in striated muscle, so that it's not confounded with long-term chronic adaptations to muscle. Okay, but what is this exactly? So let me show this to you in a couple of examples. Here we see again the typical force-length relationship with the tension or the force on the y-axis, and we have the muscle length on the x-axis. And let's take a first example. Let's say we have a muscle. The length is 2 micrometers. If we talk of sarcomeres, the velocity is 0. This means it's an isometric contraction. The activation is 1. This means it's maximal. So this means this muscle should be able to produce 100% of its force capacity. If you go to different muscle lengths, so the muscle is now shorter, let's say the length is 1.6, velocity is still 0, means still an isometric contraction, activation is 1, it produces 85% of its capacity. But now if we activate this short muscle and we stretch it to its original length, So a muscle is stretched to this length, it should again produce 100% of force, but it does not. Now it produces more force. So now it can produce roughly 115% force. And this phenomenon is the first history-dependent phenomenon and is called residual force enhancement. And in human muscles, it was observed that this can be 5 to roughly 20% of the maximal force at a given length and a given activation. So now let's move on to the second phenomenon. So again, we have here a muscle now at a length of 2.2 micrometers and velocity is zero. Again, we're doing an isometric contraction, activation is full. Because we're on the plateau region here, we can still produce 100% force. Now we go to long length, 2.5, again isometric, a muscle can produce less force. Now if we activate this muscle and we allow this muscle to shorten to its original length, so it shortens back, it should be again at 100. But again, it isn't, so the force is reduced. And if we even start at a longer length and there's more shortening amplitude, so if this long muscle, which starts at 2.8 microns, for example, shortens all the way back to 2.2, the force is even more depressed. So the muscle cannot produce its original force. And this is called residual force depression. And again, in human muscles, it's roughly 10 to 30% of the reference force. Further, it has been shown that it depends on the work produced during shortening. However, I have to say this was shown in isolated muscles, but not clearly shown in human muscles. So there's still a gap that needs to be addressed if this really depends on the work produced in human muscles. So, and on the next slide, you see a typical force time trace of these contractions I just described. In the bottom trace, you see the length of a muscle, and in the top trace, you see the force. And look first at this dashed line. The length is constant. Again, this means this is an isometric contraction. It's the reference length. The muscle is activated, it produces a given force, which is here, this dashed line, which is here constant. If we now start a muscle here at a short length, and then the green line, we activate this muscle, we stretch it to the reference length. During the stretch, the force is increased, then it drops, but it remains elevated. So, and again, we see this residual force enhancement. So this difference between the reference and the force after the stretch is called residual force enhancement. And similarly, if we start at a longer length and then we shorten the muscle to the reference length, during the shortening, the force is reduced, what we know from the force-velocity relation, but it does not recover to its original force. So it remains reduced, which is the residual force depression I already described earlier. And importantly, this has been observed on all structural levels. So single sarcomeres, for example, in Walter Herzog's lab, up to really complex multiple joint contractions in a leg press, similar to a task we do in sports or training. So it's not just something we observe in an artificial setup in a lab on a muscle fiber, we can observe it on all levels, which I think is quite important. Mm-hmm. Another very important factor, and also mentioned by Marker in its introduction, is the neural drive. So here you see AMG activity, which is matched. So you see the activity of these two contractions in gray and black is pretty much the same. And so the force should be the same. And when activity increased in this example, there were different shortening amplitudes of the muscle. And now I show you the force traces corresponding to these gray and black activities. And as you can see, there's different forces produced. The black curve is approximately 40% of the maximal force, the gray one just 30%. And this is because during this force ramp, when force was increased, there was a different amount of fascicle of muscle shortening, which then affects again the force capacity of the muscle, despite the same neural drive. Now you could argue EMG activity is not neural drive, and you're right. So this is why we further looked into this. So here you see contractions. On the right y-axis is the torque produced. And again, you have black contractions and you have gray contractions on the right. In both cases, roughly 50% of torque is produced. But the colors you see, each color represents one motor unit. A motor unit is the smallest neural unit that controls muscle force. So it's a motor nerve and the muscle fibers connected to these motor nerves.
And again, for these black contractions, there was a large shortening in this fourth REM. And for the gray contractions, there was only a small shortening in the fourth REM. And because the shortening was different, we need less neural drive for the gray contractions to produce a given force compared with the black contractions.
So this means it's not just a mechanical phenomenon, this history dependence. It also leads to modulation of the neuromuscular efficiency. This means with a given neural drive, we can produce different forces, despite length and velocity are the same. And this was nicely also shown by Jeff Powers' group.
What you see here is, again, on the y-axis, the EMG, the muscle activity, and here on the x-axis, the torque produced. And the black line in the middle is the isometric reference, the relation between torque and EMG. So in the gray curve is if you're in the force depressed state. So when you have force depression, you need more activity to produce a given force. If you're in the force enhanced state, you need less muscle activity to produce a given force.
So this means based just on the activity, we cannot predict force because of these history dependent properties. So now I hope that you understand what the history dependence is and that we have these two phenomena. We can increase the force after stretch, we can reduce the force after shortening. And I want to show you a couple of examples why I think the second part, why this is highly relevant, but mostly neglected. So for example, there's history dependence in acutely and chronically altered neuromuscular states. And the first one that was looked at was fatigue. So residual force enhancement is increased during muscle fatigue, but residual force depression is unaltered. But here, for example, this was shown for the human thumb muscle, but in a really controlled laboratory setup. So here it's unclear, and an important question in the future, can we actually use this effect, for example, to reduce fatigue during sports? Or if we have chronic fatigue, can it help, for example, here? Can we change this? A second example, why I think it's highly relevant, is when we do, you all know this, when we do unaccustomed eccentric exercise, you get muscle damage. Your muscles are hurting and are sore for roughly 2 to 7 days. So, and in this state, when you have muscle damage, both force enhancement and force depression are increased. So you could argue force enhancement might help to maintain the integrity of the muscle, but why force depression is also increased, this means even this loss in force is increased, which could be a negative effect. Here it's important to mention that there's only one study that looked at force depression and muscle damage, the study I mentioned here, the later one. So I think as well here an open question is that this is backed up by more research if force depression changes when there's eccentric muscle damage. And another example here, and also Marco mentioned this, is aging. So in natural adult aging, we become weaker, and also these properties change. So both are again increased. So there's more force enhancement, maybe helping to maintain muscle function in age during aging, but there's also more force suppression. And it's always, I think it's always harder to explain why there's more force suppression, because force is more reduced and would not help us. Why is the system designed as it is? Why is there more force depression? Now you could say, okay, history dependence is observed if you do a stretch, hold contraction, or shortening, hold contraction. But in everyday life, in sports, we do not do lengthening hold or shortening hold contractions. We move around, we do shortening, we do stretch shortening. So does it actually matter in typical contractions? And yes, it does. So there's something which is called dynamic force depression. And interestingly, there's only just this one study that investigated this systematically, and there's no study that was done on humans. So this study is based on cats or ears. So again, here it's now based on the force-velocity relation. So we know from the force-velocity relation, when the velocity is given, there can be a certain force produced. For example, if we have velocity of 0.2, we can roughly produce 0.4 force. If a muscle needs to lift the load, what we know from training, let's say you do a biceps curl and you lift the load, you can just produce a given certain velocity because of the load. So you can have both as independent variables, the force and all the velocity. And in an experiment of McDaniel, they tested this on capsuleus muscle. So what you see here is the muscle position on the y-axis and the time on the x-axis, but it's a bit different because of how they arrange their figures. So the time 0 is on the right, so it goes to the left. So, and the black line shows that the muscle will shorten from the muscle position 0 all the way to roughly 25 in millimeters. So the 75% means that there was 75% of shortening, and the 50% means there was even less shortening amplitude. And then they analyzed either the force produced or the velocity when the muscles needed to lift a given load. And again, we would expect when the velocity is the same, in each contraction condition, the force should be the same. When these muscles lift a load, we would expect that the velocity is the same because the load is constant. And now you might already expect or guess what I showed to you. So this is what they found. Again, you see here the muscle, not again, but now you see the force here on the y-axis, the muscle position on the x-axis. So the black curve, the muscle is activated, produces a force, and then it shortens to its short length. And you see the force produced. And you see these forces do not lie on top of each other, but they're different, just because they have different shortening amplitudes, but still the same activation, the same velocity. And this is not expected. So force is not the same. And if you then let these muscles lift the load, you see that these muscles can contract at different velocities. So they all lift the same load, but because of the different shortening amplitudes, so there's different velocities a muscle can produce in this case. So again, our prediction that the velocity should be the same for these contractions holds not true. So it's not constant. And to move from this capsuleus lab example to our world of sports science, just think of a squat jump. In a squat jump, you have pretty much a pure concentric contraction. And depending on the depth you start your squat jump, you have different shortening amplitudes. So you should also see this phenomenon in, for example, such a jump. But as I said, there's no study that investigated this systematically in human muscles, but I think it can be quite relevant to everyday human movement. And to move even on, you could again say also pure shortening contractions are not the most common contraction type we have in humans and in everyday life. It's potentially stretch shortening cycles. And during a stretch shortening cycle, muscle is first stretched before it shortens. And it's well known that the force, work, and power outputs increase during the shortening when you have a stretch before the shortening compared with when you have no such stretch. And the question is, where's this extra force, extra work, extra power, which we want to use also for sports performance, coming from? So it can come from pre-activation. There can be stretch reflexes. There can be recall of elastic energy from tendons or other elastic tissues. But what we could recently show with our researchers that it also depends on the history-dependent properties of muscle. I want to show you this to you in two examples. The first, in a first study in 2015, we showed this again for the thumb muscle in Walter Herzog's lab. So here you see an isometric contraction. So the angle, the joint angle, is not changing. So the force is relatively constant. Now, if you shorten the muscle from a longer length down to the same reference length, in the top brace, you can see the force is constant. During shortening, it's reduced. Then the force recovers, but it does not recover to the full amount, which I already introduced as residual force depression. Now, if you do a stretch shortening cycle, so you start at a short length, you stretch the muscle, and then you shorten to this final length, you see the force is increased during stretch. It remains increased during the shortening, but then recovers even to a higher force compared with the reference contraction. So this means if you have a stretch before shortening, the force depression can be reduced, abolished, or even turned into residual force enhancement, which depends on the speed of shortening and likely the amplitude of shortening. And why is this important? Because this force enhancement here is triggered during the stretch. So if it's triggered during the stretch and still there after the shortening, it's likely also within the shortening phase and contributes to the increased power output. Now you could say, yes, this was a human thumb muscle. There's contribution of the neural drive. There's potential contribution of stretch reflex, of elastic tendon recoil. So this is why we did a very similar experiment in Tobias Sievert's lab, and we tested red muscles on skin fibers from red muscles. So in skin fibers, you only have the contractile tissues. So what you see here is the effect really of the muscle itself. And what you can see here is the so-called work loop. You see the force on the y-axis, the sarcomere length on the x-axis. The contraction starts here where this red arrow is. So you stretch a muscle, the force is increased, it's still above 100%, and then the muscle shortens and produces force. And importantly, if you look at this gray dashed line, this is the force the muscle can produce during shortening without stretch. But if you do a stretch shortening cycle, you have more force produced during the shortening. And remember, this is a skin fiber. In a skin fiber, there's no neural system, so no stretch reflexes, no preactivation. There's no tendon, so it must be something that is within the sarcomere. And in a follow-up or in a second part of this experiment, we then block the cross bridges by using a cross bridge inhibitor. And so we can test what the elastic properties or the viscoelastic properties of a muscle compute. And we could see a similar effect. So you see the faster you stretch a muscle, so the yellow curve is at a high velocity, 85% of the maximum velocity. Blue curve is at a slow velocity. The faster you stretch the muscle, the stronger this effect of history dependence in the sarcomere. So, and again, the question is, how can we use this to potentially optimize everyday locomotion or sports performance? And this brings me to my next part of the presentation, unresolved questions and future directions. So the question I just asked was, is it actually relevant for sports performance? And again, interestingly, there's almost no research on this. There's one study from Tobias Sievert's lab where they compared weightlifters and a reference group in terms of the residual force enhancement they can produce. And also you see that it's not exactly the same between the weightlifters in gray and the reference group in white. There was no difference here. But we also need to say, so that the weightlifters, that's clear, but the reference group, this was sports science students. And of course, sports science students are also quite active. So what would be the result if you, for example, compare a cyclist who is doing mainly concentric contractions to someone who is, let's say, a downhill runner doing many eccentric contractions? Could there be differences? Or if we compare maybe an endurance athlete to a power athlete, or if we actually do an experiment on muscle fibers where we have fast twitch fibers versus slow twitch fibers. All these questions are not entirely clear and deserve attention in my eyes to foster this area in terms of increasing sports performance. So the second question, which was just recently brought up by Neil Chapman from Australia, can history dependence be used maybe to prevent injuries? And in his case, he was interested, can we use this for prevention of hamstring strain injuries, which are thought to be caused by high forces in the hamstrings. And he showed that in the hamstrings, we can actually trigger force enhancement. So you see here, the gray bar is elevated compared with the white bar. So by doing a small stretch, we can produce more force in the hamstrings with roughly the same activity, even a bit reduced. So he has not done a training study, but at least we can trigger the effect in the hamstrings. And the question is, might this help in prevention programs? And then maybe the most important question, also now leading towards our second part of the keynote, can the history dependence of muscle action be modified by training? So remember, if we stretch a muscle, we have more force. It's kind of good, cool. We're all interested as sports scientists when there's more force like this. But when we shorten the muscle, there's less force. We don't like this that much, so because it might reduce our performance. So, and there's some research, but also not much on this topic. So Jeff Powers group from Canada, they did a training study where 50 males trained 4 weeks. So one leg concentrically, the other leg eccentrically, and then they compared the history-dependent properties. So here you see this pre-training. So the black bar is the force enhancement for the eccentric training group. The white bar is for the concentric training group. And here, the residual force depression for the eccentric group in light gray and the concentric group in dark gray. And after training, they found that eccentric training actually reduced the residual force enhancement, which I thought is quite interesting. I would have thought if you train this, if you stretch the muscle all the time, this becomes more. But obviously, the opposite was true. For the concentric training group, interestingly, residual force enhancement increased. And again, it's unclear why. But also, this was just the first study on this. Further, there was no change in the residual force depression. And this study was further backed up by the same group where they did a study on rats. So one group of rats was running uphill, the other group of rats was running downhill. But they found the same results, but no change in residual force depression. So we did an own pilot study, not a full study yet, where we had three participants per training group. So we had a control group, we had a concentric group, an eccentric group. We did 6 weeks of training with the tibialis anterior muscle. We also obtained biopsies from the tibialis anterior muscle and then tested. Here you see this muscle fiber here, this fiber bundle. So we tested the human fibers then in the lab with Wolfgang Linke's lab in Münster. So, and of course, this is preliminary data, but I'd like to show you what we at least found here. So what you see is, again, the relative torque, so the force enhancement or force depression on the y-axis. You see the concentric training and the eccentric training. This is the in vivo data from the participants. And for the force enhancement, you see the black triangles and the green triangles post. So both training types, it seems this error is actually in the wrong direction, that the residual force enhancement was decreased after both training types. So the force suppression, in our case, it changed after concentric training, but not after eccentric training, which is different to what Jeff Powers found. But as I said, this is preliminary data. If you look at the results from the muscle testing from the fiber bundles, you see the control group here with overlap of the confidence intervals. So no changes in the control group. But we found here that the RFE, so the force enhancement, increased after concentric but not eccentric training, which would be similar to what Jeff Powers' group found. But here we found that the residual force depression could be changed after eccentric training but not concentric training. So you see the results are conflicting. There's no final conclusion yet, but I think especially to sports science, it's really important to answer the question, can we change these properties to potentially use them for sports performance for everyday locomotion? So this brings me to the end and why we think biomechanics and molecular biology are linked. So here you see a schematic of the sarcomere. So you see the myofilaments, the actin, the myosin, and the titin. And residual force enhancement, I haven't talked about this, is associated with stretch of the giant protein titin. Again, there's some discussion if this is actually the main mechanism, but there's increasing evidence that it plays an important role. And the force depression is linked to the cross bridges and an inhibition of the cross bridges. So these proteins and myofilaments, they're not just producing force, they're also sensing strain. And there's just, I found just two recent publications from this year. So for example, that titin mechanosensing controls skeletal muscle growth under load. This wasn't in the biophysical journal. And then in European Journal of Applied Physiology, I found another publication which addresses also mechanosignaling also in actin and myosin and the cross bridges. And why these factors are intracellular in the second part of this keynote, Barbara will also talk about extracellular things that might sense force and contribute or determine how a muscle adapts to training. So this leads me to the next part of our keynote. So I'd like to thank you for your attention. I'd like to thank my lab members and also all the collaborators. Without them, this would not have been possible. And yeah, let's look forward to the second part on from Barbara in this keynote. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much, Professor Han, for this splendid lecture that I'm sure will raise much interest. I'm sure that at the end of the session, there will be some discussions on these very interesting topics. Thank you very much. So now I pass on the floor to my co-chair, Professor Alex Ferrauti.
Thanks, Marco. Thanks, Daniel, for your brilliant talk. And as Marco said, we have a discussion about both talks at the end of the session. So therefore, it's now my pleasure to introduce the second speaker, which is Associate Professor Dr. Barbara Vesna. Barbara, you are, since a long time, part of the ECSS family, and we know each other as both we were organizing very successful ECSS congresses, 2016 in Vienna and 2017 in Essen. And I'm very happy that you are now back on the ECSS stage. A few words about where you are working. You are from the Department of Sports Science of the University in Vienna, and you are the deputy head of the Center of Sports Science at University and of University Sports. And yes, you finished your PhD in biochemistry, and your main research field is molecular muscle physiology with special regards to the intra and extra muscular connective tissue and the effects of training interventions, but also of aging on muscle remodeling. So I'm happy to announce your talk. And after Daniel was addressing more the muscle mechanical side of muscle function, you will now talk more about the molecular and physiological side of muscle function and repair. Barbara, the stage is yours.
Thank you. Also from my side, a very warm welcome to all participants listening to this plenary session. It's a pity that it's virtual, but I think it's nevertheless a good one. So I would like to thank, of course, also Marco Norici and Alexander Ferrauti for hosting the session and introducing us. And of course, the organizers of this ECSS virtual congress to give me the opportunity to give this talk. We have already heard from my previous speaker why we should care about muscles as the motors of life, he called it. And in my talk, I would try to introduce some, probably not all, structures that are involved in sensing the signals actually from the environment and to change it into some adaptations maybe. We know that the skeletal muscle is remarkably capable of regeneration following some minor damaging, so including those damages that occur evoked by strenuous training, for example, especially eccentric training. But we also know that more significant volumetric muscle loss may be caused by traumatic injury would result probably in a permanent functional impair. Well, it is quite difficult to replace such a missing skeletal muscle tissue, but I would like to start my talk by asking a simple question, or maybe not simple, but by asking a question: what would be needed to build a properly functioning skeletal muscle? So actually I took this picture as it comes from bioengineering, which is not quite common to the sports sciences, but it is quite interesting as it probably connects the biophysical as well as the biomolecular things going on in the skeletal muscle. So here you can see what would be needed for building a skeletal muscle. Of course, there would be needed cells, muscle cells, meaning skeletal muscle cells, but probably also other cells that are inherent to the skeletal muscle. They probably will produce some biological molecules in the muscle. And what is very important is actually that we need a proper scaffold, meaning that we need an ideal scaffold actually that is able to combine the biophysical properties as well as the biochemical properties of our muscle. Meaning that the biophysical properties, we have heard something about force and producing force. We have already heard about the cross-linking and so on. So we have here these biomechanical properties that are quite important, but I now would like to shift actually the focus more to these natural proteins that are inherent to muscle, and also to proteins that probably would interact with the muscle. And actually these biological properties, as well as the biophysical properties together, would build an ideal muscle tissue. Daniel has already mentioned that intracellular myosin, actin, and titin are quite important molecules. And from a molecular point of view, the connection between the passive and the active force generation in muscle is probably evident by this unique arrangement of the major myofilaments in the sarcomeres. And these major myofilaments are actually myosin and actin, but where we know a lot about those two molecules, but another molecule which was introduced not recently, but in a more previous days than the myosin and actin theories. So the titin is actually a really, really giant protein. Actually, by the way, it's the biggest protein that we know in the human body, and it contains a lot of protein domains, actually, with specific functions, and these domains are interconnected by unstructured sequences. So we have here this huge protein, titin, which interacts with the myosin and the actin in the so-called sarcomeres. And on this upper part, you can see a full sarcomere spanning from the set disc to the set disc. And actually, we have here the actin, so the thin filaments here, the myosin, the thick filament, and actually these red lines, these are the titins, which are somehow connecting the actin and the myosin. What is very important is now here, this is just half of the sarcomere, where you can see most dominantly this titin protein is actually that this titin is actually here you can see that it's not a linear molecule, it's more or less folded somehow like a spring, somehow like an irregular spring. And this is actually what Daniel already mentioned, that the titin is quite important in many actions, many muscle actions that we have here. So my next question is actually, is the size important? And actually, the titin size, so if you have a closer look to the titin molecule, if you stretch this molecule, of course, the titin is increased in its length. And by physically, actually, this causes a reduced myosin spacing, and this also causes an increased lateral stiffness. However, what is quite interesting here is that the titin molecule per se is not the same in every muscle, meaning that we have so-called different splicing isoforms, meaning that, for example, if you look to a psoas muscle and a diaphragm muscle, you can see that that the passive tension in the psoas is 2 to 3 times higher than in the diaphragma sarcomeres. And what is quite important are these gray parts here, that actually these gray parts are either there or not there when the titin molecule is expressed. And this explains the difference between the two muscle behaviors, or might explain some of the difference of the two muscle behaviors. Next question actually, is the stiffness important? When I talk about stiffness, then I just mean an increase in mechanical tension in response to the elongation of the muscle fibers. And in general, the intrinsic muscle stiffness is affected by actin-myosin interactions, but also skeletal proteins of the extracellular matrix, such as collagens. We are coming later onto this part. And to mention here is also on the sarcomeric cytoskeletal protein such as the TT. You can see here a mouse model of muscular disuse or unloading, so it's a hind limb suspension model, and you can see that depending on the time of suspension, the muscle stiffness is decreasing. Actually, it takes some time, but after 7 days, the muscle stiffness is decreasing, and it's quite interesting that after some time, it seems that there are adaptation processes ongoing, that it's still starting to increase again. And several molecular mechanisms have been questioned to be important here in these processes. And actually, one of the important parts, or one of the important explanations, is actually lying in the TTIN molecule. Actually, when you see here these TTIN molecules, you have here a special region which is very, very important and sensitive to stretching. So this is this PEVK region. And actually, what you can see is actually that it has been found that these, especially this region, has been found to lose its elasticity during this hind limb suspension. A very, very interesting study, and to somehow connect the biophysical part to the biomolecular part, is actually this study. Again, it's an animal study, and actually what you can see here is actually that they introduced a mouse model where they artificially decreased the length of the TTIN molecule. And here you can see two curves, the lower curve, so the light gray circles. This is are the so-called wild type, so normal mice. And on the other hand, the solid dark gray circles, this is this mouse model where they really shortened the TTIN, especially at this part, that I mentioned before, at the close to the PEVK domain. And what you can see here is that they determined the passive tension related to the sarcomere length in different muscles. So the upper one is the diaphragma, then EDL is the middle one, and the soleus would be the muscle at the bottom. And in all these muscles, you can see that the passive tension is highly increased in the mice with the TTIN shortening. But what is really, really interesting is actually that in the same study, the authors showed that actually this does not really affect performance. So you can see that the freewheel running here, or treadmill running, is not different between the wild type mice and the TTIN deleted mice. And what is also quite interesting is actually that the depletion of parts of the TTIN, or that the shortening of the TTIN molecule, actually led to adaptations. And actually, it led to the adaptation that the sarcomeres in Sirius per fiber were increased in all the three muscles that they had introduced. And what is really, really interesting is actually that this shortening of the TTIN actually introduced somehow hypertrophy when expressed as muscle weight normalized to tibial length. So these are these data here showing that there is an increased hypertrophy compared to the wild type mice in the TTIN mice. However, this was not translated to the cross-sectional area. What's about diabetic patients, or actually what's about older adults? And we know that aging causes muscle weakness, and we know that type 2 diabetes is also considered as a high risk factor for the introduction of skeletal muscle weakness. And in this study, Samples were taken from the gluteus maximus muscles of older adults, either with diabetes or non-diabetic patients. And the permeabilized single muscle fibers from these samples were used actually to identify the mechanical properties. And it was expected that the fiber type, that the type 1 fibers would be predominant, and actually this was all is shown here, that in both cases, so in the type 2 diabetic patients as well as the non-diabetic patients or healthy controls, actually that there is an increase, so that the predominant muscle fibers are type 1 fibers and that there is no difference between the two groups. However, that passive tension actually increased with stretch in both the diabetic 2 diabetic and the non-diabetic muscles. However, the diabetic 2 muscle fibers showed a trend of larger increments in the passive tension compared to fibers from the non-diabetic subjects. And on the left, on the right side, sorry, you can see that the ratio of titin-based and ECM-based passive tension, so the titin to the ECM-based passive tension ratio, showed a significantly lower titin to ECM ratio in the diabetic patients. So actually, this indicates that in this situation, in the long-term adaptation, that actually that other things rather than the titin would contribute to the total passive stiffness in the muscle fibers. And this is actually already a hint to the extracellular matrix. So there is something going on outside the muscle, which is not dependent on the titin or on the intracellular structures themselves. This is just the one side mentioning actually that when you perform an eccentric muscle damaging exercise, then you can find then the titin, actually this is quite interesting, is also found in the urine and hypothesized to be a mark of muscle damage. Unfortunately, there are no really studies in the human system. So most of the studies are derived from animal models to really connect the titin molecular biological properties to the mechanical strains that we have heard in the previous talk. And I already have mentioned that it's not only the intracellular part that is very important, it's also the skeletal muscle extracellular matrix that might be have a role in this process, and maybe a very dominant role in these processes. And actually, when we have a look on the muscle, then you can see here on the lower part, this is the myofiber. And here we have the basal lamina and the interstitial matrix, and the basal lamina together with the interstitial matrix comprise the extracellular matrix. The basal lamina consists primarily of type 4 collagen and laminin. These are very important, as these are the sites of the interaction with the contractile elements. However, I would like to shift your focus more or less on this upper part, on this extracellular matrix, which actually is very important, especially in the adaptation of muscle, as it is able to interact with the stem cell niche, and meaning that it is able to interact with the satellite cells, the fibroblasts, the mesenchymal stem cells, and so on, which are very important in the adaptation to especially resistance exercise, but also other type of exercises. And we know that we have age-associated changes in the collagens, which might contribute to the differences between the younger and the older participants to our studies. If you have a closer look to the extracellular matrix, or sometimes also referred to intramuscular connective tissue, then we know that the extracellular matrix accounts for up to 10% of the muscle wave. And it is actually organized into three layers. So the endomysium, which is surrounding the individual muscle fibers, the perimysium, which divides the muscles into the fascicles, and finally the epimysium, which gives external support to the entire muscle. And I've already mentioned that the extracellular matrix and especially the collagens are altered during aging. And what you can see here is actually that the collagen is increasing. And not only that the collagen content is increasing, it's also a change in the collagens as the collagen cross-linkings increase. And at the same time, the extracellular matrix stiffness increases. And in this case, the passive mechanical properties were determined for isolated individual muscle fibers, as well as bundles of muscle fibers that include their associated extracellular matrix to show the differences between the single fibers and the bundle, the muscle fibers. So if there is a difference between the single fibers and the muscle fiber bundles, then you would expect an involvement of the extracellular matrix in these actions. And what is very interesting here is also that in this study, it was looked at young and old, so young adults and old adults with respect to, so this was an animal study, it was mice. And what you can see is that actually the stress responses of the bundles from these adult mice were not different from those of the individual fibers from either adult or old mice at any of those tested sarcomere lengths. In contrast, it is quite interesting that the old fiber bundles exhibited a significantly higher stress, as you can see here in the white circles, in the white squares. And this was especially evident at longer sarcomere lengths. So can we remodel this extracellular matrix by exercise? And actually, this is a very nice review from McKay and Michael Gear. And actually, what you can see here is the difference between electrically stimulated eccentric contractions and voluntary eccentric contractions. What you can see here is actually that with respect to the function, you see a decrease in muscle force in both cases, and you see an increase in muscle soreness. But when it comes to the extracellular matrix, actually, you see a quite similar picture between these two modes of exercises. You see an increase in a very fast increase in the adenosine C, which is an extracellular matrix protein that responds very, very rapidly to more or less muscle damaging exercises. And it is important in the focal adhesion complexes that actually links the muscle cells to the extracellular matrix. Interestingly, collagen 1 and collagen 3 here are very important in the later time points, and they are thought to contribute to force transmission. Actually, as you can see here, when the collagen increase, the collagen 1 and the collagen 3 increases, this reduced force that we observe after the exercise is already increasing again. And you can see that this somehow is similar or in parallel to an increase in collagen types. And at a very later time point, key structural components of the extracellular matrix are changed, like laminin and collagen 4. So I just picked these two parts. Actually, in the review, if you're interested, there is also the response shown that macrophage activities and myofibers have in response to these two type of stimulations, and probably in this case, so this muscular response is somehow different between the electrically stimulated and the voluntary eccentric contractions. But from the extracellular matrix point of view, this seems to be quite similar. And why I would like to come to some results from our lab, and maybe you have seen that we have performed the Vienna exercise aging study, where we trained all the adults with elastic band resistance training plus or minus protein supplementation for 6 months. And actually this, as expected, leads to an increase in functional performance and also an increase in the muscle quality. But what I would like to show here is actually unpublished data. And this is actually a secondary analysis of some of the muscle biopsies, where we have these three groups. So the control group, the resistance training group, and the supplemented group also having some resistance training. And we have muscle biopsies from the baseline as well as from the 6 months after the training. So these are rested muscle samples, not subjected to acute exercise. And what we did is actually to perform an RNA sequencing to see whether other molecules, rather than the already known molecules, would be involved in this adaptation to resistance exercise. And we found actually some genes that are specifically responsive to training, or that are changed in the control, or that are changed specifically to the supplemented group. But what I want to stress here is actually when performing a pathway enrichment analysis, so to see which pathways would be changed in respect to the training study, actually it is quite interesting that one of the top scored pathways that we saw were the extracellular matrix proteoglycan pathway and the non-integrin membrane ECM interaction pathway. So we have much more molecules probably that would be involved in this adaptation, which really rely on the extracellular matrix and which rely on the long-term adaptations to exercise. In order to prove the hypothesis, some studies, I would like to rush through these studies because it's just an example. Actually, here is the difference between the young and the older subjects, which performed single leg exercises. So you can see that they were through times 12 reps at the 70% of ROM repetition maximum. And we wanted to see what's happening 6 hours post-exercise. We took the biopsies from vastus lateralis and actually applied a specific PCR array, which specifically tests extracellular matrix and adhesion molecules. And it was quite interesting that that were some differences between young and old. And as you can see here, that some genes were downregulated either in the young or downregulated in the old, or that you had genes that were upregulated either in the young or upregulated in the old. But most interestingly, we also found some genes that were really upregulated in the young ones, but downregulated in the old ones. And actually, you can see here that these genes, these are the individual data. So these are pool samples, but here are the individual data, that some of the genes that we found very interestingly are these MMPs, so matrix proteinases, which actually are involved in the extracellular matrix remodeling. So meaning that actually these MMPs degrade, for example, collagens, and actually try to get to make some space for newer, better functioning collagens, maybe. And also very interesting here is actually the collagen 7A1, actually, which was not significantly downregulated, but what is very, very interesting is that the change in the collagen 7A1 due to this acute exercise is actually nicely correlating or negatively correlating to the relative one repetition maximum of the leg extension. So it's really correlated to the the one repetition maximum here. That matrix metalloproteinases are quite important in the adaptation to exercise has been shown previously, especially on the messenger RNA level, and especially the MMP9 would be very interesting here, as it has been shown to induce quite early changes in this adaptation process. The next question that we have to address is, maybe are some exercise stimuli better suited than others to induce the extracellular matrix turnover in older adults? And this is a first study on comparing different exercise stimuli. So a conventional concentric eccentric strength exercise, then the same one added by foam rolling, then merely eccentric exercise and a plyometric exercise. And the subjects were subjected to at least two of these exercises within a crossover design. And actually what we would have expected that especially the plyometric exercise would be beneficial in introducing this mechanical part. But what was very, very interesting is actually that when it comes to extracellular matrix remodeling, that especially the foam rolling, the conventional exercise combined with the foam rolling, affected some of these markers that we tested. So to come to the end of this actually, so we know that probably the scaffold for the extracellular matrix, but also the intracellular structures within the muscle cells are very important. But probably, and actually the time is too short to go too detailed here, in other mechanisms that might be involved as well. But we probably know that biological molecules are very important as well. And so I just mention here two things that need to be addressed maybe in future studies, also in response to exercise and in response to aging or physiological changes with respect to the connection to the biophysical forces. And actually, these are the laminin dystrophins and integrins, so building the connection between the intracellular space and the outer space. And probably what is would be also very important is actually the interaction with all the other cell types that are present in the skeletal muscle, like endothelial cells, adipogenic progenitor cells, fibroblasts, immune cells like macrophages, pericytes, and many other cells that might be involved here. So I would summarize my talk with a few take-home messages. So intracellular structures such as the TTIN are probably important for force-generating capacities, but that the skeletal muscle extracellular matrix with respect to the collagens are actively contributing to the mechanical properties of the skeletal muscle, and that the extracellular matrix remodeling is very, very interesting and important process during physiological aging and adaptation to exercise stimuli that needs to be addressed maybe further also in future studies. And of course, my last two points, that the interaction with other cell types and that the interfaces between the cells and between cells and environment need to be addressed to draw the full picture. Finally, I would like to thank all my co-workers and lab members, and especially Robert Chapo, who did a lot of, who started to introducing a lot of work with the extracellular matrix, but also to our external advisors, Marco and Tony, and all the students and PhD students working in our lab. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Barbara. So we continue with the discussion about both talks, and I'm sure, Marco, you have prepared already a nice question.
Yes, indeed. Well, I'd like to thank both speakers for both excellent talks, all very exciting. We have about 10 minutes of questions, so we have to be on the point.
Yeah.
So I'd like to ask Daniel about his talk, which I really very much enjoyed, about the force enhancement. The one of the mechanisms that he introduced to explain for the force enhancement is the role of Titan. Yes, indeed, you know, this is the latest fashion and one of the most accredited mechanisms. But also, I believe there are also other mechanisms involving non-uniform sarcomeres length. Daniel, would you like to comment on that?
Yes, sure. Thanks, Marco. Yes, so the original theory was actually just as you mentioned, the sarcomere length non-uniformity theory, which means if you stretch a muscle, some sarcomeres might be really stretched to long length without overlap. So only passive structures are holding the sarcomere, and then the shorter sarcomeres, because they're in series, can produce more force. And so this likely contributes to force enhancement, but the problem is it cannot completely explain it, because first it was also shown for an isometric contraction that there's non-uniformities, and the non-uniformity is very similar between the contraction types. So another thing that cannot be explained, that you have forces that go above and the plateau of the force length relationship. So I don't think it's wrong, that theory, but I think it's part of the story. And then there's another idea from Brunello, that potentially also the second myosin head might play a role in eccentric contractions. I think no one has a really good idea why we have two myosin heads, and if they're then attaching to actin differently in different contraction types. So yes, it's not just titin, there are also other potential mechanisms contributing to that.
Thank you. And the other question, is more on the practical side, this being a sports science congress. I think it is important for our attendance to make treasure of both your talks. The data you presented clearly shows the importance of the timing of the stretch for being able to use the enhancement of force. So what recommendations can you give for the timing of the stretch for sports practitioners, if it has relevance in sports?
Yeah, the question is important, of course, for relevance in sports. I cannot really answer that. I can say you should have a small, let's say a short but very fast stretch. So from the viscoelastic properties from Titan, it should be a fast stretch, as we could show, because then we can increase the effect. But the difficulty of the in vivo setup is that we always have to consider all the aspects. Maybe if I do a very fast counter movement, let's say during a counter movement jump, I might have disadvantages from the neural side, but advantages from the mechanical side. So I think this is really a topic that needs systematic research, how we can actually use the effects best. So in terms of range of motion, producing force. So unfortunately, I cannot give recommendations yet, but I really like to motivate young upcoming researchers to move into this direction so that we can actually then, or that we know how we can use this.
Indeed, the force enhancement is an overlooked phenomenon that should be researched into. So maybe Alex would like to ask some questions at this stage. Thank you.
Yes, please, because I want to also address the practical relevance. And Daniel, I would say that the acute effects are much more important for different scenarios in sports. Can you give us an idea how long these residual force enhancement lasts? And about perhaps other impacts on that, like warm-up procedures or even cold or stretching procedures? Can we influence the amount, and how long does it last, the effect?
Yes, thanks, Alex. So first, it's important that so force enhancement is observed as long as a muscle is kept active. So if you then, but if you deactivate a muscle, the effect is gone. Then with the next contraction, you need to rebuild the effect. So it means it's not something that holds for like 10 minutes if you deactivate, but it's a thing of each contraction. But during the contraction, it remains there. But it's an important point, and this is why I moved from the stretch hold and shortening hold contractions to the dynamic contractions like stretch shortening cycle. I think this is a really relevant part, if whether these mechanisms are still there, and I think they're still there during stretch and during shortening, not after. So to your second part, so for example, there's some research if you have different temperatures in the muscle, when you have, for example, a cooled muscle in a muscle experiment, there's increased force enhancement. I don't know exactly what happens to force depression. So there might be effects, but to clearly distinguish between the PAPI effects or the PAP effects, so it's not in terms of warm up, it's really the force and power output during the contraction.
Well, Barbara, let's shift to the molecular side. A question. Well, do we need a specific extracellular matrix training? That means, are the typical strength training interventions, which are useful for hypertrophy or muscle function improvement, also suitable to improve the extracellular matrix?
Well, thank you, Alex, for this question. Actually, I think that that the conventional training regimes that we have probably would be suitable to also address the extracellular matrix, because as I've shown in this last brief results part, actually that these different types of exercise, some more, some less, addresses also the extracellular matrix. But what is actually missing at the moment is that the molecular biologists really focused for long term really on the muscle cells. And actually, they forgot to also address or to measure something which is outside the muscle. And actually, this is why we actually do not know very much about these things. And but I think that the conventional training methods could be systematically tested in order whether they also address the extracellular structures and also the intracellular structures as well, which finally are then relevant to force production.
And you said that collagen content increases with age.
Yes.
And as far as I know, all the effects of aging are not very pleasant. But on the other hand, it is recommended to, for example, have collagen supplements for strength training athletes that aims at increasing the collagen extracellular matrix. So is it good or bad? And this is the one question, and the other is it useful to increase the collagen production by giving some kind of supplements?
Yeah, well, I think the collagen content is increasing, that's right, yes, but actually, when we have a look on the muscle tissue, we do not need only to address the mere quantity, meaning it's also the quality, which is very important, meaning that if you have more collagens and if these are less functioning, then it's probably dead. Yeah, meaning that obviously this remodeling, which can be induced by training, for example, of the collagens is a very important process. So this remodeling process by the MMPs, for example. And this is quite interesting that this remodeling is much more dominant in the young ones than it is in the old ones. meaning that all things that we can do to introduce this remodeling would be quite important. And actually, with respect to collagen supplementations, there are not so many studies really addressing the extracellular matrix in the muscle. They are more investigating joints, for example, tendons, and all these things, but not so much the extracellular matrix. So I would say that if the collagen that we ingest is already derived to the muscle, then it could be beneficial as well. But for example, with the proteins where we know that they would induce the hypertrophy, we know that they are not really beneficial for the extracellular matrix.
So bringing those together, perhaps you, Barbara, has a question, have a question to Daniel, and Daniel to you, Barbara.
Shall I start? Actually, I would like to know, and maybe this is also interesting for the audience. I mean, during the preparing of my presentation, it was quite, I mean, we supposed this session was connecting the molecular biology to the biomechanics, but from your point of view, from the biomechanical point of view, what would be needed from us as molecular biologists in order to get further here on this point?
Yeah, thanks for that, Barbara. A question that intrigues me is what I also talked about towards the end of my talk is really if we can change these properties by training. And then you now looked at the extracellular matrix, but I know some of the literature, if actually, for example, properties of titin change. You also introduced that titin can be different depending on the muscles. Also, titin in the heart is different to the skeletal muscle titin. And the question, so the literature I know is quite unclear. Some show some changes in titin, others not. So this is a question, because if we could show this link, if we change titin and these history-dependent properties change, then we would, for example, really know, okay, then there's a link between these things, and then we could also potentially assign training programs.
Thank you, both speakers for the fantastic talk. I think we have 3 minutes to close. I think we have learned a lot about the complexity of muscle contraction, and how the role of a little protein, which has been recently discovered, which is titin, plays a role in the elasticity of the sarcomere and of the muscle as a whole, and can actually lead to a significant force enhancement. But the repercussion of this in terms of for in vivo function has to be ascertained, but it is something exciting to think about in the future. Also, I think it was very interesting to hear from Barbara the role of the extracellular matrix in force transmission, and the experiment that she presented about the force developed by single fibers and fiber bundles clearly showed the role of the extracellular matrix in transmitting force, and much we have to learn about the contribution of this in vivo and what happens in pathological conditions when we have muscle atrophy, and also in aging. What happens to the extracellular matrix? Is this loss of force due to also to changes in the extracellular matrix? But I think it's time to close, and I'd like to thank my co-chair, Alex Ferrauti, for sharing with me this great session, and also to the both speakers, Daniel and Barbara, for a very successful and exciting talks. Thank you very much.